says, I'll be committed to you. I'll never leave you. Nothing in this world could make me walk away. No matter what life may bring, I'll be by your side. No matter what you face, you won't be lonely. Because forever is a long time. That's how long I'll love you. That's how long I'll love you. Forever. Forever is a long time. That's how long I'll love you. That's how long. I'm forever committed to you. Forever committed to you. God says I'm gonna be right there. No matter what your life is, I'm gonna be by your side. Said I'm gonna be by your side. I'm gonna be by your side. God said I'm gonna be by your side. When you're crying, I'm right by your side. In the midst of your pain, I'm right by your side. Even with your sin, I'm right by your side.
got to remind yourself at times, when it seems like everybody's falling off, God never will. Can we just sing that together? Because I want you to implant this in your spirit. When you're driving home today, you got to remember, He still loves me. Sing.
Forever is a long time. That's how long I love you. That's how long I love you. Forever.
Come on, you sing.
Getting started a little early with some music. If this is your first time, I wish you a very good morning up here in Boston. If you're not tuning in from Boston, it's been gray for a few days, but this morning it's sunny. It feels like the world is a better place for some reason. Well, I'm so glad you're here. This is just a chance to maybe take a breath. Maybe look around a little. Settle yourselves before we settle in for Virch. I'm going to sing a couple of songs. I hope you'll join me. But like I said, sometimes we forget to breathe deep. Sometimes we forget to let go. We hold real tight. So this is your opportunity this morning. This is your invitation to take a moment. Remember who God is. Remember who you are. Let's sing together. Lyrics will be in the chat for you. Take a moment.
Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, you're lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, you're lifting my load again. There you go, you're lifting my load again.
Take a moment.
Take a moment to remember to who God is and who I am. There you go, you're lifting my load again. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, lifting my load again.
Am I held by the yoke of this world? But the yoke of Jesus, this yoke is easy, his burden is so light. Oh yeah, and no longer am I held by the yoke of this world. I come upon Jesus, his yoke is easy, his burden is so light. Burden is so light.
Lord, for those of us for whom this week has felt heavy, for those of us who are suffering under burdens, that we feel like we can't lift, Lord, we need you. We need your strength. We need to let go, we need to give up and let you shoulder our burdens. May we do that this morning.
We sing, you're lifting my load, you're lifting my load, you're lifting my load, you're lifting my load this morning, you're lifting my load. Take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. There you go, you're lifting my load again. And take a moment to remember who God is and who I am. Go, you're lifting my load again. There you go, you're lifting my load again. There you go, you're lifting my load again. Darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord, and great are darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken, and great are you, Lord, and great are you, Lord. Your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. Yes, great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord.
Friends, thank you for taking a moment to breathe with me this morning, to sing with me. It is 10:02, so we're ready to begin. Welcome to Virch. Let me pass it over to Tara.
Thanks, Matt. Hi, everyone. Welcome to Reservoir's Virtual Church, or Virch. It is so, so good to be with you here this morning. My name's Tara. Let me start off by telling you just a little bit about who we are. At Reservoir, we welcome everyone, without exception, to discover the love of Jesus, the joy of living, and the gift of community. Thank you for showing up. From my own personal experience, it can be hard to show up. So thank you for showing up and for being here. Whether you're in your pajamas or if you've been up for hours, if you're here fully attentive or your mind is, you know, on the other side of the room or even out the window, thank you for being here. However you are, wherever you are, you're welcome this morning, just as you are. I'll start off with a few announcements and then we'll move into the service. For those of you on Zoom, we'll have the order of service posted in the chat so you'll know what to expect. And after these announcements, we'll have a song, then a spiritual practice, and then you'll hear today's sermon before we close with the final song and a benediction. As you logged on this morning, a few minutes before service started, you may have noticed some news and information slides on a loop. These included some events and happenings that you can engage in. We will post these slides for easy access on our website, reservoirchurch.org, along with a recording of the sermon. And these will all be posted tomorrow morning, so you can find them in the sermon section of the website. Right now, I'll just highlight a few of those events so that we can draw our attention to them. And for those of you on Zoom, you can access the links in the chat. For those on YouTube, you can visit our website during the week for links or email anyone on staff. It's just their first name at reservoirchurch.org. So the first announcement we have for you all this morning is our prayer vigil. So we will be holding a prayer vigil for hope and healing two Sundays from now. It's on May 2nd and it'll be right after Birch at 11:15. Come with your prayer, come with your song, come with your favorite word of declaration for hope and healing that's centered around the experiences of BIPOC communities, Black, Indigenous, Asian American, and people of color. All are welcome, again, without exception, to attend and listen and stand in solidarity. We are asking that if you wish to attend, that you register and sign up. That link is in the chat. And after registering, you will receive a confirmation email containing information about joining the meeting. Our next event and happening is Poetry Night. This is our April edition. We've been doing this for, I think, since the pandemic started. And our next one is going to be next Sunday at 6 p.m., April 25th. Join us if you love to just listen to poetry and want to hear some new ones, or if you would like to read an original poem or a favorite poem, all are welcome to this as well. Also, feel free to bring a friend. Anyone is welcome to join us. You can email Matt for more information. It's Matt, M-A-T-T, at reservoirchurch.org. And then the link for that meeting is in the chat. Our next event and happening is Jerry's Pond Cleanup. So this is also next Sunday, April 25th. We will gather at Jerry's Pond to help make our community a better place. So come join us as we meet our neighbors and we clean up the perimeter of Jerry's Pond. This will be an afternoon of service with some fun activities and a live band. So please come with your masks and we'll get started at 2 p.m. Then we'll be following that with, we'll follow all social distance guidelines while we're cleaning up, and gloves and trash bags for the cleanup will be provided. You can email Lydia, L-Y-D-I-A, at reservoirchurch.org if you'd like to join us next Sunday. And then we also would like to tell you all about our Ready team. We've been talking about it over the last few weeks. I'm one of the members of the Ready team over the last couple of years. And we are so excited. We're looking for some new team members. We've extended the deadline to May 1st. I did this at our members meeting. I'll do this now too. If you would like to, you could open up your email right now and put ready at reservoirchurch.org into the to field. And then the body of the message, just say, I'm interested in learning more about the Ready Team, or I would like to join the Ready Team, or I have this great friend who would make a great addition to the Ready Team. We'd love to hear from you. We just want to make sure that we have really good representation of the diversity of our church community in this important work. So if you care about justice and love diving into equity, diversity, and inclusion efforts, please take me up on that, open up your email, and send us a note. You can find more information as well on our website. And I believe that email and link are in the chat now. And then finally, getting plugged in. There are a lot of different on-ramps to getting plugged into Reservoir. And you'll see that on the slide. They range from financially giving to joining a community group to joining our weekly emails. You're welcome to try any or all of these, or you can just get started with the welcome form. When I started at Reservoir, I just filled out the welcome form as my very first on-ramp into Reservoir, and it's a great way to get to know the church. We would also love to connect with you if you would like for some one-on-one prayer. You can email Kate, C-A-T-E, at reservoirchurch.org anytime now before 11 a.m. with your phone number, and someone from our prayer team will give you a call after service. Before I turn this back over to Matt, I'm going to pray for us through a poem that I've been holding really close recently. It's called Holding the Light by Stuart Christenbaum. Gather up whatever is glittering in the gutter, whatever has tumbled in the waves or fallen in the flames out of the sky. For it is not only our hearts that are broken, but the heart of the world as well. Stitch it back together. Make a place where the day speaks to the night and the earth speaks to the sky. In our imperfect world, we are meant to repair and stitch together what beauty there is. Stitch it with compassion and wire. See how everything we have made gathers the light inside itself and overflows. A blessing. Amen. Back over to you, Matt. Thank you.
Thanks, Tara. What a beautiful poem, prayer. I love it. Well, friends, we are going to sing a song together. I invite you to sing with us. This is a newish song to Reservoir. We've done it one time before, so I will say what I said last time. These are lyrics that I think we can all get behind. And they're certainly very close to my heart this week, of all weeks. But I think it's important to note that the lyricist, the author, is a Black woman. And so we're singing words from the perspective of an African-American woman. And I think it's important for us to listen to the music like in its original context. So what I'm doing right now is I'm posting the links to our Spotify playlist and our YouTube playlist. The song's called See the Day, and so you should check it out. You should sing with me right now, but in your own time, I invite you to check it out. It's a great song. It's a great recording. Anyway, let's sing together. See the day.
I wanna see the day when justice rolls like a mighty river floods out of control. May that day be the day when together we'll say, let justice roll. Oh, let justice roll. Oh,
I want want to see the day. I want to see the day when love shakes the ground and the walls that separate come tumbling down. May that day be the day when together we say, let love, love shake the ground. Oh, love shake the ground. Oh, I wanna see the day when we all stand tall and the heavy hand of oppression is finally gone. Well, may that day be the day when together we say, precious Lord, won't you lead us on? Oh, come lead us on. Oh, may that day be the day when together we say, precious Lord, won't you lead us on? Yeah. Say amen. All right, let me pass it off to Tricia for our spiritual practice.
Thanks, Matt. Amen, amen. Hey, everyone. Happy Sunday to you. I'm always feel like I have spiritual practice in a really tough week. I'm tired today. Yesterday, I was tired too. And tomorrow, I will probably be tired. Yet, I have found energy in the nourishment of stillness, family, sisterhood. Today in my tiredness, I go in hope and faith to find continued strength and energy, the steady nourishment that God invites us into daily. In faith, I look for, listen, and yield to the Spirit of God. So in a moment, I'll invite us to listen and yield to the Spirit of God. Please come with an open heart as we attempt to anchor ourselves, some of the basic fundamental ways of listening and engaging with the Spirit of God within us and within others. So first, we'll take a posture of thanksgiving and humility before God that allows us to lay down our burdens and yield control. This could look like an outstretch of hands. If you're old school, kneeling on your knees, bowing your head. Go ahead, just take a posture. And a breath. And begin to think of things you're thankful for. Feel free to praise God for those things. Now we'll pray in faith. We invite your Spirit. In faith, we yield to your Spirit. You can repeat this a few times if you'd like. Faith, invite your Spirit. Faith, we yield to your Spirit. Now be still. And notice what comes to mind. Listen, notice your thoughts, notice areas of need, thoughts of action, clarity, or just receive God's peace. You don't need to understand everything or have everything figured out. Just notice, just trust. Repeat this prayer. In faith, I trust the Spirit of God within me. In faith, I trust the Spirit of God within me. Invite God to expand the knowing of your Spirit within and around you. God, will you expand? God, you expand the knowing of your Spirit within and around us. Now open your eyes. Take a breath. Look at these images and ask yourself, is God's Spirit here? Where is God's Spirit? Where is God's Spirit? Let us end by praying together, Namaste, which means may the Spirit of God in me greet the Spirit of God in you. The Spirit of God in me greets the Spirit of God in you. May the Spirit of God in me greet the Spirit of God in you. May the Spirit of God in me recognize the Spirit of God in you. For this is the simple work you've been called to do ever since the Spirit hovered over the waters. Namaste. 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 I turn it over to Ivy.
Thank you, Tricia. Namaste. Namaste. May it be our guiding prayer as we walk and breathe and have our being on this earth. I also wanted to reiterate an announcement that happened at the beginning of service today, which is this prayer vigil that's coming up in two Sundays on May 2nd. It's for hope and for healing. You're invited to come with a prayer, come with a song. It'll be space given to the voices of Black, Indigenous, Asian American, and people of color. All are welcome to attend, though, to listen and to stand in solidarity. Sign up. If you would like to come, you'll be invited to register through a link that's going in the chat now. And after registering, you can receive and will receive a confirmation email containing information about how to join that meeting on that date. It's good to be with you, my friends, this morning. I'm Ivy, a pastor here on staff, and I'm going to share some words around this new series we're in called Listening to the Spirit with Freedom and Power. It's an invitation to both chronologically follow the events of early followers of Jesus and how they found their way with the Spirit of God in those early post-resurrection days that were bewildering and confusing and laced with fear. And it's also an invitation for us to consider what we think of the Spirit of God in these days. As Tricia led us through those images in the spiritual practice, maybe you felt those questions rise in you. Where is the Spirit of God? Where do I recognize it? What does it mean to listen to the Spirit? And what does that listening call us unto? Our Lenten season centered the voices of minor prophets and concluded with the promise of God that we hear in the minor prophet of Joel, where it says, "I will pour out my Spirit on all people." not just kings, prophets, and judges, people that had status and were separate and had power and religious value, but that it would be poured out, this Spirit would be poured out on all people. Today, this is the phrase I want us to mine deeply, to revisit with fresh awareness. Because not only is this vital to our own experience of flourishing and wellness, especially in days of chaos and hurt, and not only is it essential in piercing through boundaries and limits of where we have set who God is or where God is, but it is also vital for our conceptions of what the gospel is and who and what church is. So let us revisit this promise that God will indeed pour out God's Spirit on all people. Today, we'll look at words shared to us in the book of Acts, particularly those of Stephen, a voice that echoes around us with the Spirit of God just as strong today, a voice that if we still ourselves long enough to listen, may just help us believe that the resurrection story is an everyday possibility, not just an Easter story, that death and violence and hatred will not be the message that wins out, that soaks into our veins and into our next generations, but it will be a message of life and love that we create with the Spirit of God that wins out, where the gospel and church represent the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God calls us out into liberation and into new ways of living alongside one another, calling us into beloved community, which will take more than our human efforts and our human imaginations. It will take the power and inspiration and courage of the Spirit of God. Let me pray for us. Oh, tender Holy One, in faith, this morning we ask for your presence, alive in us, freshen us, tune us to your movement within, in the midst of us, and beyond us. Amen. About 3 years ago at this time, I took a trip to Duke University for a several-day conference. And the conference itself took place in Duke's Chapel, this outstandingly gorgeous building right in the center of campus. Actually, I guess it's the tallest, most prominent university chapel in the world. And the first session of the first day started with this woman leading us in worship. And I don't even remember the song or the words. I just remember her singular voice starting us off with no instruments, just her voice echoing off these ancient stone walls and traveling up to the cavernous ceiling, reverberating back down. It was so stunning. And in a room of 1,000 or so strangers, it was uniting. And the holiness, the Spirit of God, I felt it reverberate through all of us. Over the course of the next few days, all of our sessions were centered in this sanctuary. All the big speakers and all the great worship happened in this building, except for this one opportunity where you could choose from a myriad of different breakout options. And one of them was to go off campus, required taking a bus a few miles away in Durham and visiting this property that was a school, actually a school called the School for Conversion. It was also a church, St. John's Missionary Baptist Church, and it was also declared sanctuary for a member of the neighborhood, Jose Chicas, who was being faced with the risk of deportation due to increased ICE raids in the area. He had been living there for a year at that point. So we were invited to go to this property and invite to meet a representative of all of that, a guy named Jonathan Wilson Hartgrove. And so there was a lot going on there that I was really curious about, wanted to hear more about, like a church, a school, a neighborhood, sanctuary, community, and sort of what was the vision in all of that, the plan, the through line, the program. And also, as you might guess, I was a little suspect of this word conversion. Conversion has been a word that was often synonymous for me in my faith history with the word gospel. I was taught that I held the gospel, the power to convert others, which then would give them this separate and holier status. Conversion, though, in its truest form, is a new way of being, and actually an ongoing, ever-evolving way of being, as we think of it situated in a context of faith where we believe in a living, resurrected God who is fully in our life. Conversion is a transformation of heart. It's an active process that follows the movement of the Spirit of God. That's not always visible or defined, but one that unmistakably introduces us into new patterns, spheres, and people. And as Stephen shows us in the book of Acts, this newness and expanse that the Spirit of God might bring us into is not always embraced or accepted by those in power. So I want to press into Stephen's story a little bit here. We meet Stephen in chapter 6 of Acts, where he's chosen to help with the daily distribution of food to widows who were being discriminated against. And we see here that he's described as one who is full of faith and the Holy Spirit, and as one who performs many amazing signs and miracles. This gains the attention of the religious elite, and they behold Stephen as a threat to their position and their way of understanding God. So they persuaded some men to lie about Stephen, saying, "This man is always speaking against the temple and against the law of Moses. We've heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth will destroy the temple and change the customs Moses handed down to us." And so they arrested him and brought him before the religious council. These accusations are a big deal. Stephen knows that to continue to live in the Spirit presses against the honoring of hierarchies, of religious authorities. He's transgressing the borders, closing the distance between insider and outsider, neighbor and foreigner, stranger and friend, suggesting that the Spirit of God sees and recognizes no boundaries. Stephen responds to the council, and his response is about 50 verses in chapter 7 of Acts. I won't read them all, but it's super powerful, and I want to summarize some of it. It's interesting about his response to the council, because he doesn't start with a list of retorts for each point he's been accused of. Instead, he decides to remind this religious council of the movement of the Spirit of God to all of God's people over the history of time. And so he starts way back with Abraham, and he details the movement of God throughout lands, out of Egypt, through the Red Sea, and back and forth through the wilderness, the widening circles and borders and cultures that God embraces. And he reminds the council of God's promises that have occurred throughout history to all of these people and how God came through on them. He reminds the council of the Spirit of God's bewildering ways, of how God created a whole nation from Abraham and his descendants, even though there were no children at the time. He reminds the council of Jacob and Isaac and Joseph and Moses, who are pivotal characters in the religious elite's present-day understanding of God. He reminds them of the Spirit of God who speaks through people and bushes and angels and fire, occurring in curious ways, but always present. The Spirit of God, always present. He also reminds the council in this historical recollection that at every turn, the Spirit of God has been rejected, forgotten, disbelieved by the people of God again and again throughout history. Stephen's address ends with these powerful words that pick up at the end of Acts 7, which I'll show you and invite you to see here on slides. He goes on with this historical recollection to say, "Years later, when Joshua led our ancestors into battle against the nations that God drove out of this land, the tabernacle was taken with them into their new territory, and it stayed there until the time of King David. David found favor with God and asked for the privilege of building a permanent temple for the God of Jacob, but it was Solomon who actually built it. However, the Most High doesn't live in temples made by human hands. As the prophet says, "Heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool. Could you build me a temple as good as that?" asked the Lord. "Could you build me such a resting place? Didn't my hands make both heaven and earth? You stubborn people, you are heathen at heart and deaf to the truth. Must you forever resist the Holy Spirit?" Stephen ends here with the words of the prophet Isaiah, challenging them to consider that the words of God, "Didn't my hands make both heaven and earth?" Oh, religious council, can you understand that God's presence has been and will always be present everywhere, covering heaven and earth? And do you see that your God is the same God of Abraham? And like Joel's words, "I pour out my spirit on all people," can you see that I, Stephen, have the same spirit of God in me that is present in you? Stephen shows and calls out in the same way that prophets do, big patterns. They're seers of big patterns. They see what has always been true and will forever be true of God. And Stephen here recognizes that one of the big patterns of God is that God's message of love and spirit always gets wider and wider and more universal. That God is in all things. It's profound because Stephen is showing here to the council that is accusing him and will shortly murder him through stoning, that the very truths that they speak of and are so vehemently protecting and guarding, the good news that speaks of the incredible power and goodness of God for all people, is being warped and turned into bad news as they use it against people in their midst. And herein, Stephen not only reveals a big pattern of God, but also reveals one of the biggest patterns of humanity, our continued effort to limit the Spirit of God, to discredit the Spirit of God, to cover our ears and not listen to the Spirit of God. The pattern over history is that we, the bearers of God's image and spirit, are the destructive forces that hijack the gospel, resisting it by believing that faith is our business to manage, our tool to use on other people or society. I think this is why it's so important to figure out where we are with the Spirit of God today, because the Spirit of God calls us out to continue the good work of reconstructing the gospel, to keep converting, transforming to new ways of being in beloved community with one another. The council before Stephen couldn't listen to the truth that Stephen, by way of the Spirit of God, revealed in his speech. So much so that it says in verse 57, that they put their hands over their ears and drowning out his voice with their own shouts, they rushed him, dragged him out of the city, and stoned him. Handfuls of stone and handfuls of certainty. As suspect as I was getting off the bus in North Carolina and walking a few blocks over to this school for conversion, I warmed to Jonathan Wilson Hartgrove as I listened to him. He spoke of church as it is in the New Testament, in the Greek translation, ecclesia, translated as the called out ones, which he said is to be called out of the patterns and practices of this world's sinful and broken systems and be brought into the economy of God's abundance and grace, which is enough for everyone. This, he said, is to be church. To participate in an institution called church that reinforces the world's broken systems is easy, But to live by the Spirit is messier because it requires that we, that which we can't fully know, the person in front of us. And the only bridge to knowing is love. As Jesus says in his first sermon, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because the Spirit has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. This is the gospel, to challenge the injustices of poverty, those who have been made poor and kept poor by unjust systems. And what if this first sermon was an invitation not to create or imagine a bunch of auxiliary ministries dependent on the central mission of church? But what if it was a calling out of the Spirit of God as a way of living with love in this world and fighting everything that comes against that love by the power of the Spirit? You see, to walk by the power of the Spirit in an unpredictable world is one that liberates us from the most powerful, authoritative, hierarchical institutions and systems that lay in our land. And this freedom, this liberation, is what the council didn't like. Stephen was living alongside people more than he was in the temple. He was being the gospel more than he was studying the Mosaic laws. He was walking alongside, sharing his food with those who had been abandoned and cast aside, the widows. And yet the council can't figure it out. What is the shape of this? What was the plan, the spelled out vision, the structure? How could they know if what Stephen was doing was really of God or not? And they couldn't. It was too unpredictable, too mysterious. One might say even miraculous. And herein lies the miracles we get to encounter with the Spirit of God. The miracle is that the Spirit of God can be found in backyards and at playgrounds and in neighborhoods and in offices, in you and in me and in all of us, if, as Tricia invited us to consider, we choose to recognize it. God is in all things. Our days are overflowing with miracles. What I discovered as I learned more about Jonathan Wilson Hartgrove's work, which by the way was by standing in a parking lot of this property, because it really wasn't as much about the building or what was going on inside the building as a school or as a church or a sanctuary. It was more about the way of life that was found as he engaged with his community and neighborhood, as he was part of the area that surrounded him. And this way of being has led to meaningful partnerships with so many folks in his area, including Reverend William J. Barber, who created the Poor People's Campaign of Moral Revival. It's led to Jose Chicas being free to reunite with his family after 1,300 days in sanctuary. It's led to this school for conversion being shaped by God's vision of a beloved community. It's led to the embodiment of conversion as not being a separate set of doctrines that people have to subscribe to, but a way of life that leads us all toward that beloved community, a new way of living together and being in the world. And it's led the church to be not primarily about how many people show up for services, but rather about how many who are oppressed will encounter liberation. It's about how many neighborhoods and families and individuals can be freed by the oppressive structures that continually try to limit life and limit the Spirit of God. And here we are today, the church, in this post-resurrection reality, just 2 weeks out from celebrating Easter with one another, right? Declaring that Christ is risen, Christ is here, Christ is alive, and our hearts are burning within us with this awareness and hope. And yet we start this week again with death. Another murder of a Black man at the hands of police, Dante Wright, a 20-year-old, a bearer of the image of God, full of joy, given to laughter, a loving father, full of life, full of God's Spirit. we would do well to listen to the Spirit of God. And we would do well to listen to the question that Dante asks of us in his death. Do you recognize the Spirit of God in me? Stephen says the Most High doesn't live in temples made by human hands. It's us. We are the temples. We are the living, breathing sanctuaries filled with the Spirit of God, capable of miracles, capable of loving those around us. Yet Stephen poses piercing questions, right? Will we listen to the Spirit of God? Or will we be a stubborn people, heathen at heart and deaf to truth? Or will we be able in faith to trust like Moses did, and in faith suffer like Joseph did, and in faith persevere like Abraham? Will we be able to push against the spirit of our times, against power, against violence, like Stephen did? Howard Thurman says, to listen to the Spirit of God in our hearts often calls us out to act against the spirit of our times, and often causes us to anticipate a spirit which is yet in the making. Stephen listened to the spirit that was yet in the making, and he invited this council of religious elite to listen to the spirit that was yet in the making, the free, powerful, unboundaried Spirit of God. And in that, he invited them to answer the same question Dante Wright does of us today, one that they couldn't face and embody, one that they covered their ears to. Do you recognize the Spirit of God in me? God says in Joel, turn to me now, while there is time. Give me your hearts. Come with fasting, weeping, and mourning. Don't tear your clothing in your grief, but tear your hearts instead. Return to the Lord your God, for God is merciful and compassionate. May we return. May we return to God, to the good, loving, powerful story of God in our lives that has been written over the arc of history, so that we can write it into the future, and so that our efforts to rid this world's system of racism and every other sickening toxin are freed from white supremacy, addressing our hearts and our souls in the light of God's mercy and compassion, so that we can greet one another with namaste, with reverence, and with honor. May the Spirit of God in me greet the Spirit of God in you. And may we continue to become the church, embodying the Spirit of God that calls us out. Amen. And now pass it over to Matt, who invites us into worship.
Amen. May it be so. Friends, we're going to close with one more song, but before we do that, I want to remind you that we have a prayer team who would love to pray for you, with you. If you want to be prayed for, prayed with, you can email Kate Nelson. I'm going to put her email in the chat. Also, our prayer team has been listening to the Spirit this morning. They felt like they would love to pray in particular for anyone suffering from lower back pain, anyone feeling like they're juggling things and would like God to help those balls fall into place, anyone suffering from allergies, and those having a hard time trusting God and being vulnerable in this time of challenges and transition. You feel like they want to say God wants the full measure of God's joy for those people. So you've been prayed for, but if you want to receive prayer one-on-one, email Kate. Her email's in the chat. Let us sing together. All right. I love that song. Well, friends, that almost brings us to the conclusion of this part of our service. But wait, don't go yet. We want to close with a benediction, but before we close, I have a request of you. So please don't sign off yet. As you know, our team, our staff team, are thinking and imagining ways that we can safely gather back together in person. And we're also trying to imagine ways that we can continue our online service. We can innovate and make it the best online service that we could possibly make it. And so today, I would like to request that if you're an out-of-towner, so if you're watching Virch right now from somewhere, from a location that would make it difficult for you to attend one of our in-person services in Cambridge, I would love to talk to you. I want to hear about your experience, why you're with us, all of those things. So you could do one of two things. You could drop your email in the chat right now, and I'll get in touch with you. Or you could email me, Matt, M-A-T-T, at reservoirchurch.org. I would love to chat with you just to get your perspective and to learn how we can keep holding on to our digital congregation. All right, that's enough from me. Let me close us with a benediction. May the God who creates and sustains everything be with you this week. May you feel God's face smile upon you as you go from this place. And may God give you peace, my friends. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, that concludes this part of our virtual service, but the fun's not over. If you want to continue, if you want to say hello to some people, maybe share about how your week is going, we have our wave call that is on a meeting link that is being dropped in the chat. It's already been dropped in the chat. Thank you to whoever did that. So copy that link, or you'll find that link in your email if you're subscribed to our email list. So grab that link. Hope to see you on the wave call. If you're not going to join us on the wave call, I hope you have a lovely week. I'm going to stick around for a couple more seconds to make sure everyone gets that link copied and pasted. And I want to copy and paste some of these emails. Thank you. All right, friends. It has been great to be with you all this week. Happy Sunday. See you next week. Bye.